Tai ačiū labai organizatoriams. Visada malonu atvažiuoti, paklausyti į įdomią konferenciją ir įdomi tuo, kad iš įvairių fizikos sričių yra. Paprastai nuvažiuoji kokią konferenciją, klausai savo tik tais srities, o čia iš visų sričių kai kartais gimsta naujos įdomios idėjos. Tai šiek tiek pamatysit, aš kombinuoju idėjas ir iš lazerinės fizikos, ir biofizikos, vaizdavimo, ir tas atneša naujas kryptis, galima pradėti, ir na, šiaip jau įdomių dalykų atsiranda. Pabandysiu kalbėti angliškai pranešimą, nes kai kurie terminai visada užkliuo ir pradedi galvoti, kaip tą ar tą pavadinti. Okay, so I'll switch to English. And so this is a work what we have been doing for several years. I will present new results, some unpublished results, and it will be about ultrastructural microscopy. You have heard from Rimas Jasiūnas, Juškaitis, atsiprašau. Juškaitis introduced quite a bit about microscopy. It's one of the earliest instruments that you had. And it moved further and was a Nobel Prize awarded for super resolution microscopy. So an idea that when you have an image and you want the highest and highest resolution, you can get to super resolution. But a spectroscopist and microscopist and laser physicists, we know that intensity in the image is just a one parameter, but it can be spectrum, can be lifetimes, can be many other parameters. So in this case, I will use polarization to extract information beyond the diffraction limited resolution. Not only intensity, but to tell something more about biological system. Acknowledgements, not to forget at the end, my group at one of the parties in the lovely afternoon we had in my backyard, and a lot of work, what I will show, is by Lukas Kontenis, who just graduated and is returning these days as we speak to Lithuania, will be in the light conversion company. So it's nice that the knowledge which we got and in other parts of the world are returning to Lithuania. So you will see him around. The work also is done in collaboration with University Health Network of Toronto. It's the third largest health network in the world. So a lot of doctors are helping us with different measurements. And we also started collaboration with National Cancer Institute, with Richardas Rotomskis on the heart conduction systems, and other cool stuff comes out of nice collaborations. So I'll start my talk from the teaser. You have here the larva, Drosophila larva. It's about 3 millimeters. And on the right side, you have a movie. I hope it will play. And what you see here is the second harmonic image. So it's live, how that larva is contracting. And what you see, those blinking spots, it's a second harmonic generation from a small structures called sarcomeres. Those are contracting units. And if you think that the muscle which you are using is contracting in unison, it's not. So each blinking shows a difference in the contraction efficiency for that one contracting unit, which is about 10 microns. And the efficiency also corresponds to second harmonic generation change. So now, as a laser physicist, for example, we would ask what is happening that the biological, usually we have crystals generate second harmonic. Here, that second harmonic efficiency is changing in the biological matter as it works, as it produces contraction. So we need to investigate and understand what is going on. Here is just to show you that we are developing technologies of new microscopes. So here, for example, is an ytterbium oscillator, which produces 12 watts output at 60 megahertz, and then it is coupled to a microscope. It's a home-built microscope. We focus the sample, focus the beam on the sample just below the sample, because at the sample or the focus we would have about 5 to 6 watts, and in 1 micron we can start micro machining. So we have to defocus the beam, and then we collect second harmonic. That's one of the newest microscopes, which are not available on the market, but we have the possibility to make them. So now switching to deeper to understand why the intensity of second harmonic is changing, we decided to use polarizations and develop a nonlinear Stokes-Muller polarimetry theory. Here you see, for example, a Muller matrix. Usually Muller matrix is 4 by 4 elements. If it's nonlinear, it gets 4 by 9, and then if it's third harmonic Muller matrix, it gets 4 by 16 elements. So I'll show you little by little how we get to the measurement and extract nonlinear susceptibilities from it. So probably you know from undergraduate optics that if you measure with Stokes, you come with Stokes beam, and then you measure the properties of Stokes vector after it goes through the matter, then that Muller matrix can tell everything about the media. And that's in the linear regime. If you have non-linear regime, then you have two beams in and second harmonic out, or three beams in and third harmonic out. So you can construct similar things with nonlinear Stokes-Muller polarimetry, again, to extract that Muller tensor. So the matrix is for two-dimensional Stokes-Muller polarimetry 4 by 9, so for third harmonic is 4 by 16, that Muller matrix can be transformed to correlation X matrix, and that correlation X matrix is like density matrix or coherency matrix, what you have, where you have the correlations between susceptibilities, and they tell details about the matter, biological or non-biological. How we measure, we prepare that Stokes vector, double Stokes vector, we measure then second harmonic Stokes vector, and then we measure different polarizations, and we construct then the double Stokes matrix, and we measure second harmonic Stokes matrix and obtain Muller matrix, which can tell many different things about the structure itself. So here is the setup. So we have a beam, and then it's standard laser scanning microscope. Then the beam is scanned and collected, and what's different that we have polarization state generator, polarization state analyzer, which can be, the polarization states can be changed or measured at will, and we collect the data to obtain the Mueller matrix. So we prepare Stokes vector, we measure the second harmonic Stokes vector, then we extract Mueller matrix. From Mueller matrix, we can extract the correlation X matrix, which is the tells about the susceptibilities of the material in each pixel of the image, because it's an imaging technique. So each pixel gives that the chi X matrix. We can measure also degree of polarization, linear or circular polarization, and that's because it is a Stokes formalism. If we would have Jones formalism, then we wouldn't be able to account for scattering. So, and biological materials are scattering, so it's additional information for us to know what's in that biological system. So here is the measurement. So we have nine polarization states, and for each polarization state, we have a Stokes vector images, and those images are from muscle. Again, what you saw before in the movie was blinking, so that's each sarcomere. Here is at high resolution. That sarcomere is actually each striated line, it's a striated muscle. And from that measurement, we can look at the degree of polarization. For example, here there is a, if we have right circular or left circular polarized light, then we have scattering of circular polarized light. From this, we get Mueller matrix. From Mueller matrix, we can extract the susceptibility tensor elements, and what's important is those two elements, ZZZ, means that excitation is along the fiber and detection is along the fiber, versus excitation is perpendicular to the fibers and detection along the fiber. So that ratio tells a lot about the structure of the system. So if we look at cross-section, here is the intensity, so that's striated structure, and if you look at the ratio of the those ZZZ over ZXX is lower than in those darker regions. So that means the structure is different, and when this muscle contracts, that there is a dynamic that the susceptibility ratio is changing, and telling the information what is in each pixel, so ultrastructural information from those measurements. Here is the slide, what we did in collaboration. Here was Cancer Institute, was Rotomsky's group, and here you see heart conduction system of the human, and you see collagen, for example, in that place, so the ratio is showing collagen regions, those are ratios showing muscle region, blue are where the muscles are, so what I showed, and here the a part of the conduction system, and you see that there are changes in that ratio, which tells the changes in ultrastructural information. Now, what ultrastructural information we can get, that's my next point. So here, for example, you see a collagen. Those fibers are collagen fibers of extracellular matrix in the tissue, and it's a bone tissue, and then when it gets cancer, that those collagen fibers get more disordered. So we can measure that with second harmonic generation polarimetry. So what we do, we get that X matrix, those are images, just it's no point showing so many images this you can imagine X matrix, and then from that X matrix you can diagonalize, get the eigenvalue, so you can calculate the entropy of that matter in each pixel of the image. So we can measure the entropy of the material. If we look, for example, in human ovarian tissue, so you see here the similar to second harmonic generation, the fibers, you see different fibers here, and then if we look at the dominant eigenvalue versus total normalized trace of the susceptibility matrix, you see that there is almost straight line, and then if we calculate entropy, is about 0.4 for the healthy human ovarian tissue. Now, if we go to, for example, tumor tissue again, if we look just at the disorder in the tissue itself, you get to 0.5, 0.55 entropy. So entropy changes in the extracellular matrix as cancer develops, and that can be used for diagnostics, for pathology. Pathologists usually don't see collagen. It's not very well visible in the H&E slides. That's how they diagnose cancer. They look at such slides. But with the polarization measurements, we can extract the order parameter from the tissue. And if you look, quartz has, for example, entropy 0.22, while tumor gets to the values of 0.52. And the normal ovarian tissue is 0.39. So there is a significant change in the order. So here, for example, is human breast tissue, again, normal. Normal tissue, second harmonic image, ratio image. If we look at the ratio, what I showed, ZZZ over ZXX, it's around 2. When we go to tumor, these are different tumors for breast tumors, depending on the what receptors are expressed in those tumors. And then the ratios are increasing. And that can be used, for example, for diagnostics. The relating parameters to the entropy of the tissue is degree of polarization. Again, with simple degree of polarization, you already can start seeing changes in degree of polarization as well. So really, the cancer is changing the extracellular matrix. And for the end, I wanted to show you third harmonic generation Stokes-Muller polarimetry as well. There were carotenoid aggregates mentioned, and here the experiments were done in carrots. Carrots produce very nice carotenoid aggregates. You see them bright, shiny. Here is the schematics of the carrot aggregates. It's possible to do Stokes-Muller polarimetry or for third harmonic to extract chi3 instead of chi2. So then it's 4 by 16 measurement matrix, Muller matrix, and then we can extract the susceptibility values of different components, and they appear to be complex. So next stage, of course, to go to the spectral resolution and see what the spectrum of such aggregate would look and what would be the susceptibility tensors for such aggregates. And it can be then combined second harmonic with third harmonic, so polarimetry can be done simultaneously on both objects, and each pixel can be analyzed, and susceptibility values, the orientations of those pixel symmetry axis can be extracted, and we can tell quite a bit about the ultrastructural information in each of that pixel. So in summary, what I showed you, how to use Stokes-Muller polarimetry, nonlinear Stokes-Muller polarimetry, how we got Müller matrices and then X matrices, extracting the order parameter of the tissue and then the ratio of the tissue and how we got to the complex values of susceptibility, which give us additional information. So we are going deeper and deeper into extracting more ultrastructural information from the biological samples. So thank you. We'll entertain the questions.
Turim dar šiek tiek laiko klausimams, jeigu kas, prašau.
Kaip nu?
Košia. Bet dauguma vaizdų, kur čia rodė, tai išfiksuotų bandinių. Tai kaip čia viskas?
Nu, visų pirma, jeigu košė pasidarytų, antros harmonikos nebesusigeneruotų. Tai vadinasi, to košės ten nėra. Kiek keičiasi, matomų pasikeitimų nėra, kontrolinius darėm. Matavimus praktiškai nesikeičia šitie santykiai susceptibility ratio. Tai kas, ypač antroji harmonika, matyt, kai yra fiksuojami bandiniai, tai crosslinkingas yra netvarkus ir matyta netvarka, jinai palyginus su kristalinė kolageno struktūra yra nežymi ir praktiškai nesimato.
Struktūra tokia stipri, kad net fiksavimas nepagadina jos pakankamai.
Bet tą patį galima daryti nefiksuotam dalykui. Čia paprasčiausiai patogu, kadangi patologai naudoja
vargas, aš
stikliukus, tai mes tik pridedam kitą kontrastą.
Ačiū.
How we can measure the entropy in the medium?
So we are measuring in a way the entropy of the eigenvalues of the susceptibility matrix, which corresponds to the entropy of the medium. So it is correspondence. It's not direct measurement, as you understand, of entropy of the medium. It's entropy of susceptibility eigenvalues, but it is corresponding.
Taip, ar būtų dar kokių klausimų? Taip, prašau.
Tiesiog mano toks būtinis labai klausimas, ar jūsų savo matavimą matuojat tik tai paviršius, ar ir į
tūris
į tūrį irgi įlys gali taudinio.
Taip, kadangi fokusuojam, fokusuojant harmoniką generuojasi tik tais nuo fokuse, tai maždaug kubinis mikronas. Ir tą galim į gilį lysti, tą daryti optical section, šimtą mikrometrų labai paprastai, paskui prasideda ten daugiau sklaidos, bet iki 200 mikrometrų galim lysti. Daugiau vėl problemos yra įvairūs sprendimo būdai, bet daugiau problematikos.
Bent jau dešimt lastelių galima sluoksnių matyti.
Taip, galima trimačius vaizdus daryti ir Stokso Müllerį galima naudoti paskui trimačiam vaizdam rekonstruoti. Aha.